Welcome back to Sunday Morning Quickies, episode 45 for the 5th of June, 2022. This week we're going to be doing a whole bunch of little short subjects on Sunday Morning Quickies. The first one, we're going to look at an oil wick that a lot of people have been asking about in a Singer 27 or 127, or actually all of the Singer vibrating shuttle machines. Going back through my backlog of questions that I wanted to answer on camera, this is a Singer model 27 in as found condition. I haven't bothered to look up the serial number. Let's just say, for argument's sake, it's well over 100 years old. Anyway, I get a lot of questions about, is there supposed to be, type questions, a oil wick underneath the slide? Let me show you where that goes. Yes, there is. This hole right here. Okay, you can see right here, that's where the hole is for the oil wick. Now, there's a port that comes out through the side of that hole. I'm going to take these very fine tweezers and I'm going to push through. You can see where the tweezer is coming through. Oops, let me get back in the hole. You can see where the tweezer is coming through inside that port. What works fine for that is the same 3/16 inch diameter firm felt cord that we use for motor wicks on, say, a 201-2 or 1591, any of the Singer potted motors. What you can do, you can insert the wick all the way into the hole, and then I'm going to pull it out using the diagonal cutter. Now, I'm going to back it out just slightly. I want maybe a 64th of an inch, and I cut it. And I'm going to put it back in the hole. This way, it goes down just slightly below the top of the surface here. Make sure that's seated. It is seated. And when we load this up with sewing machine oil, I have to give that a few times, let that soak in completely. It'll take a few drops. It might take a few applications. You want to do this until it stops. It stops soaking. Okay, that pretty much stops soaking, and we can take a paper towel and wipe off the excess. That's now going to do its job by using, in this case, I used the tweezers to poke into the hole. That ensured that there was nothing in there that was going to be blocking it up. You can use an old dead sewing machine needle, a pin, whatever. Just make sure that that hole, that port that goes out to where the shuttle comes by, make sure that that is free and open so that this wick is actually able to oil something. Several people have asked me recently about these aftermarket Chinese-made 9-spoke balance wheels. Well, we're going to take a look at the difference between one of these and an original Singer, as well as a control, a solid hand wheel. Yeah, we're back with this Godzilla 66 one more time. One thing that the machine's owner had asked me was to see if a 9-spoke hand wheel would fit on the machine, and it's a reasonable enough request, and yeah, I was pretty sure that it would. These parts are pretty interchangeable throughout, and I happen to have a bunch of machines that have 9-spoke hand wheels, a bunch of old red eyes. Anyway, I wanted to find out if one of the Chinesium ones that you can get online, if those are, number one, any good, and number two, if they're going to fit. And my findings, you might find kind of surprising. So we're starting out, here is a typical solid hand wheel that, this is actually the one that came with the machine. It fits in its normal position. I can spin it around. it goes on backwards all the way. No big deal, but we expected that. That's what came with it. Here's one from a immediate post-World War I era 66. Goes on all the way, not a problem. Let's flip it around. Goes on all the way. And when I say all the way, I mean that the bushing extends beyond the center so that you can get the stop motion washer on. Now, why would you want to put it on backwards? I don't know. I don't care. The reason I started playing around with backwards, here's a Chinesium one that I got off eBay. It goes on. I'm looking at it. I'll show you something. It doesn't go all the way on. Here, let me zoom the camera in on this so you can see exactly what I'm seeing. Notice the gap. And here, let me put something behind it that's white so you can see the gap a little easier. See that? See that gap there? This isn't going all the way. Let me show you an original. No gaposis. The solid hand wheel that came with the machine. No gaposis. So, why is this giving us that gap? Let's take a look. All right, I'm going to flip it around the opposite direction. Oh my, it doesn't go onto the bushing. Well, there's your problem, lady. If you buy one of these Chinesium hand wheels, be prepared to deburr the inside of the hole on both sides. See if that solves our... Nope, hasn't removed everything yet, but it's getting better. So, how am I going to deburr that? It's cast iron. It doesn't want to deburr nicely. So, I'm going to use a stone to deburr this. Believe it or not, you don't have to be super pretty with the way you deburr it, because you're only deburring the very edge. So if it's not the prettiest, you just want to get it so that you can get past that, so that you can get the stop-motion bushing exposed. So I'm going to use a rotary tool with a stone. We'll wipe it out, we'll check it. The edge of the bushing is coming through, and I have a feeling, yuppers, it goes on in both directions. We got the burr out, and it fits just fine. So let's put a stop motion washer on it. Odds are I'm going to have this backwards. We know that. That's the way life works. Bada bing, bada boom. And there we go. That's all it took. Well, there you have it. You can go from a motor with a solid wheel to a Chinese hand crank and a Chinese spoked wheel for like $50 via eBay. That is, if you don't have an original 9-spoke wheel. The eBay stuff will work. Just, if it doesn't fit properly, just remember, a stone and a rotary tool, deburr it, check which way it fits, make sure it fits in both directions, double check the gaposis. Now, the customer did not send me the bobbin winder with this machine. She has since sent it to me. I'm waiting for it to arrive. I'm going to do her bobbin winder when it shows up this week. But and she does have a 9-spoke wheel for it, but I wanted to try this out on this machine. So there you have it. 9-spoke will work. And yeah, for those who are wondering, these inexpensive Chinese hand cranks can work just fine. stitches look pretty darn good.
I know I've already done a series of videos, there must be four or five of them out there, on various bobbin winders for the Singer Model 66. Well, we're going to do another one again, one that we've already done, but it's one that's going to be used on this Godzilla 66.
Well, this goes along with the 66 that I've been working on for Audrie. She had originally not sent me a bobbin winder for the machine. Now, keep in mind, she wanted to use a, she likes the spoked hand wheel style. So, her Godzilla machine is going to wind up not using a solid hand wheel. She's going to use a spoked hand wheel. And to do that, you actually cannot use on a 66, 16, or 18. You can't use the stock, the original bobbin winder with a spoked hand wheel. It just won't make contact. So, we got chatting, and it was agreed that she was going to send me what she was going to use for her bobbin winder. In that case, this is a bobbin winder that came off of a red eye. And, but as you can see, it's obviously in quite crappy condition. So I'm going to refurbish that for her. This is coming apart slowly now. A lot of this is rather rusted. There we go. It's stuck. So we'll get it apart and we'll clean it up. And oh my God, is this thing nasty? That's okay. The machine that she sent was pretty nasty too, so what's a nasty bobbin winder on top of it? It's no big deal, that's what it is. So I'm just getting everything apart initially, and we'll take it from there. I've done a number of videos on these bobbin winders, so the various flavors of bobbin winders that Singer used on these machines. If I'm not mistaken, it's like three or four different bobbin winders that I've shown. This is one of the very common styles. Like I said, this is off of a red eye. There's really nothing super special about it. And find the right size wrench. 9/32. Yeah, it's a tight fit, but it will. So let's get put a little bit of mouse milk on that just to break that free. Yes, you're seeing correctly. I am putting a dirty towel on top of a relatively clean towel to try to keep the relatively clean towel somewhat clean. Does it make sense? Darn right it does. Because, oh my God, is this thing nasty. And get a little bit of oil down the back here. A little oil down the front. Break this off. There we go. All right, get the washer off. There's the washer. All right, this is disgusting. This is very, very disgusting. All right, here's your before. Let me see what I can do with this. I'll be back. We're going to start the reassembly, as we always do on this style bobbin winder, by taking this portion of the bracket and attaching it to the belt guard. Now, we're going to make sure that this screw goes all the way in, because it is shouldered, as you can see. But once again, and as I've explained in the past, doing so ensures that this bracket is going to be lined up properly, which will make putting the bobbin winder itself back on considerably easier. So, there we go. That's on. And we will remove. Actually, let's make sure that's good and tight. Okay, now we can remove this screw and know that the hole and the bracket are in proper registration. We'll put the spring for the winder on. I've already put a new tire on this. I did that as part of the cleaning process, just to make my life a little bit easier. Not that my life is ever easy. And I'll get the spring all the way back into the detent, wind it around and into the detent. There it goes. Put the same screw that we just used. Oop, just popped out. Just used. Bring it around. Now holding this out, I'm going to go ahead and hold that down and run that screw in. Oops. And now we have good spring action on the winder. We had no spring action on that winder earlier. That's how dirty that was. I'm going to take the spring that goes on the bobbin follower, put it into the bracket thusly, and get its other side of the spring started. Then we will drop its screw in, and we're just going to get the screw just started on this. Just barely started. And we're going to bring it around, hook it over, and then run the screw home the rest of the way. And you'll see now we have excellent snap action on the winder. Okay, let's get the winding portion done. We're going to start with the thread guide. I'm going to put, there's two tabs coming off of the spring. One that is close, it's pretty much in line with the spring body, and the other one that projects out a little bit. The one that's close aboard, that aligns with the spring body, is going to go in first, and it's going to go on thusly with its tab in. And I'm going to take the thread guide, drop it so that the other tab is in, and I'm just going to run the screw all the way down. And now you'll see we have a nice little snap action on that. Okay, we've got the thread guide on. Now I'm going to put the spring washer, that little concave washer, in place. I'm going to take the main gear with its cam on the bottom. I'm going to put the heart, the top of the heart, towards the gear up top. No particular reason, that's just the way I always do it. And then I'm going to push the screw through and spin it around a little bit just to make sure it's engaged, and now it is. I'm going to flip it over and just get the nut on the bottom just started. Get it so that it's touching but not tight. Next, bring out my machinist vise with an extension from my Chapman set and a bit that fits the eccentric screw. What I'm going to do is I'm going to hold the guide out of the way and I'm just going to lightly turn. Actually get this in a better position here so you can see. I'm going to lightly turn so that that gear, the big gear, comes into contact without jamming up. That appears to be good now. I can just give it a little jiggle and it barely moves, which is fine. We don't want it. We don't want too much engagement here. If it binds at all, it is way too tight. You want this to be smooth. Once we have it where we want it, we put this screwdriver bit into the screw, and we take our wrench and we snug up that. A great way of testing these bobbin winders, take your drill, and you like to use my little cordless one, and run it, run your drill, and then press the bobbin tire up and make sure that the mechanism moves. And there you go. That bobbin winder is ready to be installed on the machine. Now, the astute observer might note that this particular bobbin winder that's now on this machine is not the type that originally came with this version of 66. And you would be correct in that observation. What is happening here, though, is my customer told me she wants to use, and she's going to use, a 9-spoke hand wheel because she likes those. Not that she's going to put it in a treadle or anything, she just happens to like the 9-spoke hand wheels. So, the standard bobbin winder for this machine will not work. The one that would work fine with a solid hand wheel won't work with a 9-spoke. It just won't make contact. However, taking one from a 66, from an earlier 66, from like a red eye, that does work. So now we have this in place. We engage. It's turning. It's moving that bobbin winder. Bada bing, bada boom. So yeah, in answer to the question, that's why this one has a an old original style bobbin winder on it. It's because that's what the customer is going to be using. She's going to be using a 9-spoke hand wheel. It's the only bobbin winder that'll fit.
Well, there you have it. That's what I've got for you this week. Hey, nice, short, sweet, to the point. Well, kinda. Anyway, thank you so much for watching, and we will see you on the next one.